normally, but it's a progressive disease. Polio in the acute stage is a flaccid paralysis. Then in the first 6 months, there is some recovery, and within 18 months, some more recovery can take place. So cerebral palsy is a fixed insult to the brain. The others are kind of changing insults. So that is the definition which you must all try to understand. Now, this is a practical kind of class, so I'm not going into too much of theory. As soon as you get a suspected case of poliomyelitis, there are so many other milestones, but you should try to understand these three basic milestones. You must ask hand holding, which normally takes place at the age of 3 months, sitting at the age of 6 months, and standing by the age of 1 year. So if they are delayed, they are in favor of a cerebral palsy patient. Now, a little anoxia to the brain can cause a lifelong damage. Sometimes I am fond of Urdu Shairi also. I say that Lamho ne khata ki, sadiyon ne saza paayi. Lamhe means a moment of anoxia to the brain, and the patient suffers for the rest of his life. We have to improve our maternal services, our health services to prevent cerebral palsy cases, but still they keep on occurring. Now, as I said you, if there is a loss of milestone, cerebral palsy, the milestone which is once gained is generally not lost. Whereas in other diseases, progressive neurological disorders, the milestones can be lost subsequently after attaining also. So cerebral palsy patient, he starts sitting, he keeps on sitting. So milestone once lost, if it is lost, if once achieved is lost, is not cerebral palsy generally. Now, few classifications. One is a physiological classification. This is based on the tracts of the nervous system which are involved. The commonest variety is the spastic variety, where the corticospinal tracts are involved. The other variety are rigid, hypotonic, dystonic, depending on which part of the brain is involved. So many of them could have ataxia, many of them could have seizures, and there's a mixed type of picture. So this is depending on, but the commonest variety is the spastic type of cerebral palsy. Now there is a geographical classification depending on which part of the body is involved. So in monoplasia, you will get one limb involved. Paraplasia, both lower limbs are involved. So I think these are all self-understanding, you can easily understand all of them. But the headings which have been given in blue, they are the common varieties of cerebral palsy. Spastic diplegia and hemiplegia, they are the common types of cerebral palsy. Double hemiplegia means spastic diplegia, the lower limbs are involved more than the upper limbs, whereas in double hemiplegia, the upper limbs are involved more than the lower limbs. So this is to be understood. Now this is a typical example of a patient with a spastic diplegia. He is walking with the knees flexed, his ankles are in the boilers. We will study more of such cases. The upper limbs are relatively normal. Now the next common type is spastic hemiplegia. The incidence of this type of cerebral palsy is approximately 30%. So one side of the body is involved, but then the upper limb is more involved. 50% of them are mentally retarded and 33% could have seizures. Spastic quadriplegia, this is the most severe variety where all four limbs are involved. Most patients are mentally retarded, they have seizures, they are non-walkers most of the time, 80% of them. Now, whenever a parent brings to you a child with cerebral palsy, it is the natural curiosity in the mind of the patient. He'll ask the doctor, sir, whether my son or daughter will ever be able to walk. So you have to answer this question. It may be very difficult to answer this question and very heartbreaking also if you tell them the real answer, but very tactically, at least there are many other criteria given, but they are too difficult for you as orthopaedic surgeon, you should understand. That if a child is able to sit by the age of 2 years, generally they will have an independent ambulation. This may not be an absolute truth, but by and large, they are likely to be independent ambulators. And the ability to walk plateaus by the age of 7 years. That means the child who has not walked independently till the age of 7 years generally may not walk. But we have seen exceptions with severe deformities, with correction, they start walking sometimes. But these are gross two things which you should understand when a parent, anxious parents wants to know what is the prognosis for his child. Now, out of these, spastic hemiplegia has the best chance of ambulation and spastic diplegia is the second best chance of ambulation. Now, after you have initially thought that this is a case of cerebral palsy, now you start examining this patient. You examine first the cone of the patient. Now, the cone can be a clasp knife type or a rigid type. Commonest one is the clasp-knife type, which is because of the cortical spinal tract involvement. This is clasp-knife is a velocity-dependent increase in tone. When you slowly, suppose for example, if the quadriceps is spastic, you slowly bend the knee, you may not elicit much spasticity. But if you suddenly do it, the stretch reflex is stimulated and you will get a spasticity, and it will just like break like the resistance of the knife. It's called a clasp-knife injury. Now, in cases of other neuromuscular disorders, you do MRC grading of muscles. You know 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, the muscular power. But in the caveat to such a thing when you are dealing with a spastic patient, you can't be that simplistic like 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Because when you touch a patient who has spasticity, the stretch reflex is stimulated. And the patient may appear to have much more power than what he actually has. So you have to be careful in labeling the power as 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. You can say mild, moderate, and fair, some such thing. It cannot be precisely 0, 1, and 2, 3, 4. And then subsequently, you will evaluate the deformities which this child had and what we can do to correct those deformities. And equilibrium and standing balance also should be analyzed. And of course, the history or during examination, you must elicit whether there are any seizures, whether there is a bladder control. So all those things, whether the child is deaf, there are many other things which can be associated. So they also have to be taken into consideration when you are managing such cases. Now, when you are going to test the muscle power, I'll just give you a practical clue because it is a cortical level lesion. Now, suppose a patient is having a paralysis of the ankle dorsiflexor. If you simply ask him to dorsiflex the ankle like this, he may not be able to do it. But you make him sit like this and you ask him to flex the hip. That means ileus was contraction, the ankle involuntarily dorsiflexes. But this is during the swing phase of the gait, the swing phase muscles. So they both simultaneously get. So by testing the ileus first, you can test the ankle dorsiflexor also. So you have to learn these nitty-gritties sometimes in cases of cerebral palsy. So this is called Phelps confusion test. And the next thing which is to be understood is the concept of biarticular muscles. This is very important because you know there are certain muscles which cross more than one joint of the body. Not only biarticular, there can be tri or polyarticular muscles also, but this is a basic concept which I want you to understand. These muscles, once they cross two joints, they may have opposing action against the at each joint. I'll give you an example. So these are the three muscles which you should remember. If you understand the anatomy of the gastrosoleus, you will know that the gastrocnemius tendon is arising from the femoral condyle, is crossing the knee joint, whereas soleus is arising from the soleal line on the tibia, and both are attached similarly here. So the soleus is actually an extensor of the knee. Combined gastrosoleus is the plantar flexor of the knee. Gastrocnemius is the flexor of the knee, but isolated soleus, since it pulls the tibia backward on the soleal line, it acts like an extensor of the knee also sometimes. This, so if one end of the muscle is fixed, the other starts acting. You understand, the origin can act as an insertion and insertion can act as an origin if one side is fixed. Similarly, hamstring muscles, they are all arising from the ischial tuberosity. And then they are all crossing the knee joint, attaching on the medial side and the lateral side. So they are flexors of the knee and extensors of the hip. If you fix the knee, they become extensors of the hip. Sorry, I think one or two more muscles are left. So now this muscle, rectus femoris, which is arising from the supra-sternal tubercle, this is a flexor of the hip and extensor of the knee. And one more muscle, gracilis, which is arising from the symphysis pubis here and is attached below the tibia. So this I'll explain how to test this muscle later on. So these are the muscles which are important, particularly when you are evaluating the lower limb deformity. Now the presentation of cerebral palsy can be varied. There can be the best form of cerebral palsy, mean mildest form, where the child is intelligent and is simply having a slight toe wobble. So that's fine. He will do well and not much of a problem. And this is the most severe variety of cerebral palsy. The child is wheelchair bound, he is spastic, diaphragic with seizures. He may not be able to communicate, he may have seizures, he may have loss of bladder control, so many such things. So the mildest form to the severest form, this is the whole spectrum of cerebral palsy. Now the patients who have not started walking at the time when you first examine them, they can have some of these gaits. They can be crawling like a quadruped, or they can be bunny hopping. Bunny hopping means like a rabbit, they are doing this. So spastic diaplegics often do this, and crawling, so they can be crawling also. But if the child is already walking, so they may have one of these ambulatory gaits. So since they may have ataxia, so they may walk like this. Now this is why they are walking like this, because they have a loss, they are not able to keep the center of gravity within the two legs. So they may have to outstretch the hand like this. So this is like a tightrope walker in the circus, who may hold a pole to keep the center of gravity in between the pole, and they prefer to run rather than walk. Now you will understand, according to the Newton's third law of motion, walking slowly is more difficult than running as far as the balance is concerned. When you are learning cycling, so slacking is more difficult than fast cycling. So they may prefer, sometimes they simply like to run. If you ask them to slowly walk, they may be more unstable. And then other things you understand, they may have increased lumbar lordosis, scissoring like this, crouch like this, where the ankles are dorsiflex, the knees flex, jump gait, we'll discuss all these gaits slowly. Other thing is to be seen is the rotational profile of the lower limbs. Now this is to be understood in this concept, if this is a straight wire or if this is a straight line. Normally when I walk, all of us keep our feet in 10 to 15 degree of external rotation. This is the normal foot progression angle, which is about 15 degree. Now the patients can walk with a straight foot and they can walk like this. So this is in-toeing gait, which is also called pigeon gait. And often in cerebral palsy, this type of gait is seen. The reason for that is, though, I think you should all know, the pigeon gait, they can arise from excessive antiversion of the hip. They can be because of the tibial torsion, or they can sometimes be because of the metatarsus as well. But in cerebral palsy, the commonest variety will be because of excessive femoral antiversion. And if there is excessive femoral antiversion, the femur has to internally rotate to keep the head in the socket. Why cerebral palsy patients develop in-toeing gait is, you see, when the child is born, the normal antiversion is around 40 degrees. And as he grows and starts walking, the angle is reduced from 40 degrees to adult level of 20 to 25 degrees. Now cerebral palsy says the milestones are all delayed, so that stimulus for correction of the antiversion doesn't take place. So they continue to have an excessive femoral antiversion and they may continue to walk like this. Alright? And this is somebody observing this gait, and then you can also measure the foot thigh angle to find out whether a patient is particularly having a femoral torsion or is it tibial torsion. Now, what is the role of surgery? Surgery in cerebral palsy is easy. Tendon lengthening, tendon flexion lengthening is easy, but the decision to make the surgery is more difficult. So a young orthopaedic surgeon who is fully trained to do a tendon electrical lengthening, he immediately like to correct all the deformities in the case of cerebral palsy. But then you must understand the next line which I have written here. The capability to perform a surgery should not become an indication. You are capable to do a tendon lengthening, tendon electrical lengthening. Since you know it, that should not become an indication. The important thing in cerebral palsy is to find out whether this surgery is going to help him or harm him. There is a possibility, many surgeries which you may think they are going to help him may harm the child. So, merely capability to perform a surgery should not become an indication. The surgery is simple, but the decision to make a surgery is more difficult. And subsequently, what are the roles of surgery? To reduce the spasticity, to balance the muscle power by tendon transfers, to improve the posture of the child, sitting or standing posture, to prevent dislocation and correction of deformity, and stabilizing the joints and the spine. Now this is a practical part which I want you all to understand, the difference between the contracture and spasticity. When we were dealing with post-polio residual paralysis, the usual deformity was because of contractures. In poliomyelitis, the acute myofascial contractures during the acute soldier were very severe, particularly the iliotibial band contracture, they used to produce flexion, abduction, external rotation, the problem, the knee flexion. It used to affect everything from the hip down to the ankle. So contracture is a true shortening in the length of the structure. And you have to lengthen that structure back to its normalcy so that the deformity gets corrected. Whereas spasticity, most of the time, the length of the muscle is all right. When you are putting a patient under general anesthesia, you will find the length become normal. You may find whatever requirements were there, that may not be there. So, What is the take-home message from here? If you lengthen a muscle which is not short, this will damage. You simply have to reduce this spasticity by doing something simpler rather than totally lengthening that muscle. So this is very important to understand contracture versus spasticity. And that most of the time, even in acquired deformity in cerebral palsy, PL lengthening is almost contraindicated. Very rarely, in exceptional cases, PL lengthening is done. Generally, the gastrocnemius part of the tendoaxis is spastic, so you have to do limited surgery to reduce the spasticity of the gastrocnemius rather than lengthening the whole tendon. So contracture versus spasticity. Now, I think this I have already explained. And conventional that plastic. Now, there was a time, bulbous release is very common these days for pelvis equinus in cerebral palsy. When I was a resident, procedure of denervation of the posterior tibial nerve was very commonly practiced. You see the patient with an equinus deformity comes, we used to give an anesthetic block to the posterior tibial nerve. And you find a patient who is walking with spasticity, with the reduction of the spasticity, he starts walking normally. But this is also a test that once you denervate this nerve, the patient will start walking normally. But now, instead of denervation, a selected fractional lengthening or release of the gastrocnemius is recommended surgery for equinus. Now, these are the common deformities, and I think you are very, very familiar with the nomenclature of all these deformities being orthopedic surgeons. But just for your practice, I would like to mention what is the varus and valgus deformity. Varus deformity and valgus deformity, they are deformities. For example, varus is a deformity in the coronal plane of the body, in which the part which is distal to the apex is pointing toward the midline. Valgus, the part which is distal to the deformity is pointing away from the midline. Fixed flexion deformity, for example, is a deformity in the sagittal plane of the body. So when you are asked to define any such thing, it gives a good impression that you are talking of the plane as well as how the deformity looks like, though it may appear very simplistic. So this is a case of spastic equinus in case of cerebral palsy. And in this case, when the knee is extended, the ankle is in equinus. Most of the time, if you constantly press this ankle persistently and sustained, the deformity may get corrected. That means the spasticity which is built inside the muscle is gradually released and the ankle comes back to normal. And another test which is practiced for such cases is called Silber-Shewell test. It is written as K but pronounced as Sh because of the language. And when you flex this knee, the deformity gets corrected. The reason is that most of the time it's the gastrocnemius component of the tendoaxis which is spastic. When you flex the knee, the deformity gets easily corrected. So you know that by releasing the gastrocnemius, I'll be able to correct the deformity. So, what is the pathogenesis of deformity? I think I've already touched upon a little bit. So, muscular imbalance, spasticity versus contracture, dynamics of bone growth, I've already explained. So, if a child is having a equinus deformity at the age of 4 years, I'll be hesitant to do a bulbous lead at that time. If facilities are available, I may like to inject a Botox, which is a costly injection. Botox is a drug which is acetylcholine esterase inhibitor. It will paralyze the motor head plate for about 6 months' time. And you can use this window period to do an orthotic treatment or a plaster application to reduce the spasticity. And because if you do the surgery right now at this stage, you may have to repeat it, as I told you, when the child grows, the deformity will grow with time. And particularly during the growth spurts, the deformity is rapidly increased, the skeleton grows, these tissues are not able to relax along with that. So, treatment in cerebral palsy, it is orthopedic surgery is one minor part in treatment of cerebral palsy. Many other professionals are involved, social workers, speech therapists, neurologists. Any kind of help is welcome in these cases. You put this back child who is lying like this to make him try to stand. So, various other disciplines are important. Now, what are the treatment options for restoring muscle lengthening? The basic principles are, so you are either weakening the strong spastic muscle, or you are strengthening weak muscles by physiotherapy, or you are augmenting strength of a muscle group by tendon transfer. These are the three things which are practiced to correct a deformity in the case of cerebral palsy. Now, for non-operative treatment, with or without Botox, you may have to do a plaster of Paris casting. You may have to use orthosis or Botox plus casting. Now this graph is meant for you to understand that during the first 5 to 6 years, Botox and orthotic treatment, if possible, is desirable treatment. No surgical intervention is generally recommended. But during the age between 6 to 15 or 7 to 15, a definitive surgery may be planned because the child stops growing after the second growth spurts, and you can do a definitive surgical correction in such cases where you don't have to repeat the surgical intervention again. Now, this is Botox. I have already touched upon this. So, generally used for children who are less than 4 or children who are less than 8 to keep the deformity under control before definitive surgical correction. The types of AFO, solid AFO, I think there will be a whole class on AFOs and prosthetics by Dr. Matthew Burgess. He will explain to you all this. But these are the various kind of orthotic devices with a joint, without joint, a flow reaction orthosis. So all these devices may be useful to keep the deformity under check. This is a classical workpiece which are doing the gastrocnemius lengthening. And this is one of my cases where you make an incision and just separate the gastrocnemius from the soleus component. And dorsiflex the ankle, the muscle will slide and correct the deformity. TA lengthening is generally to be condemned in cases with cerebral palsy, but there are often on some cases where they have a true contracture. If a patient under anesthesia, particularly when you try to correct this deformity, it doesn't get corrected, sometimes it may be indicated. The incidence should be very low and you should be very hesitant to do a tendinitis lengthening in the case of cerebral palsy. Equinovarus deformity. Now, what is the muscular imbalance in equinovarus deformity? The posterior tibial subialis posterior is spastic and the peroneum may be weak and the foot goes like this. So what can we do? Here also, like in CTV, tibialis posterior is completely cut most of the time. But here you will do a fractional lengthening of the tibialis posterior, and then you may have to do a split transfer of the tibialis anterior. Tibialis anterior, which usually attached on the base of the first metatarsal, you can take out the insertion, split into two, like a Y, you can attach like a sling, one on the medial side and one on the lateral side. The lateral side will help in eversion, thereby correcting the deformity. Now, valgus. Valgus is a bad deformity. Generally, tendon transfers are not able to control it. And often, a such bony procedure may have to be done. So there are two bony procedures which are recommended for this. One is a Grice-Green's extra articular arthrodesis. Usually, conventional arthrodesis are not recommended below the age of 10 years. Because if you try to do that, you will have to remove a lot of cartilage, because bones are all cartilage. In the foot particularly, the occipitic nucleus is running in the center of the bone. So to reach up to the bone, you have to remove a large amount of cartilage. So extra articular arthrodesis are practiced. You may have to take graft from the tibia and insert in the sinus tarsi, invert this and correct the deformity. There's another procedure called bachelor's procedure where you can take the fibula, make a hole from the top of the talus, go up into the subtalar joint and correct the subtalar joint deformity. Now crouch gait. This is the second most common deformity after the ankle and the knee. We are now coming to the knee. Now crouch is this. In crouch, the knee is flexed but the ankle is dorsiflexed. The reason for crouch gait is hamstring spasticity. So here, the pelvis may be tilted backward also. As I told you, the hamstrings are extensors of the hip. They are flexor of the knee, extensor of the hip. So they will extend the hip and they will also flex the knee joint. And the foot is actually in dorsiflexion. But this appears to be some kind of requirements because this child has been walking like this for a long time and there is a midfoot break. Because of the midfoot break, the equinus has become like a rocker bottom foot. Because he has been walking like this, so the heel seems to be slightly higher. But actually, this is a dorsiflexion. Now, this is an example of a crouch gait in one of my patients. We will skip this. Now, patients who also have a tight hamstring, they will have a problem with the sitting balance. Because as I told you, when the hamstrings are tight, the hip goes into extension. So they are not able to straight sit like this. The pelvis is pulled backward. So they are sitting like this. And their sitting balance also improved. This is one of the videos which shows this very clearly. So you see this child is having hamstring tightness. And as the residents are slowly extending the knee joint, you find the child tends to fall backward. He continues to fall backward, because of the hamstrings acting as extensors of the leg. And when you try to flex the hamstring, he tends to come back to the knee. So not only in walking, but in the sitting balance also, the hamstring will be able to improve the posture of the patient. Now, how to find out that the hamstrings are tight? So, you can do the conventional straight leg raising test also, but this is a test which is described by Waltz, pop angle, where you flex the hip, flex the knee, and then try to extend the knee. If the hamstrings are tight, you will not be able to fully extend the knee. The angle is here between the calf and the long axis of the thigh. The normal angle up to 40 degrees may be considered normal, which doesn't need lengthening. Beyond that, hamstrings are tight, and you may have to do a fractional lengthening of the hamstrings. And out of the hamstrings also, generally biceps is most often not touched. The medial hamstrings, which are more tendinous and aponeurotic, they are often touched. Biceps may also be touched in severe cases, but the semitendinous and the medial hamstrings are more often touched than the biceps. So this is one of the cases where this is a fractional lengthening. Actually, I'm not doing anything to the muscle. What we are doing is cutting the aponeurosis of the semitendinosus, taking slits, and then the tendon is effectively lengthened. Now jump gate. This is over. This is for me. Should I continue? So jump gate is a combined, I told you 40 minutes I take. Jump gate will be hamstring tightness along with the gastrocnemius tightness, and the ankle is in equinus in these cases rather than ankle in dorsiflexion. Now this is a true equinus, where there is an equinus and the knee is straight. In fact, the knee can go into hyperextension. In jump gate, the hamstrings are tight, even the equinus, the gastrosoleus is tight. And this is a apparent equinus. You see, this looks like equinus, but when you see this angle, this is just about 90 degrees. In such a case, if you lengthen the gastrocnemius, you will decompensate this patient, and whatever little he was walking, he'll stop walking. And then crouch gate, I've already discussed. This is a diagrammatic representation. So these are various tests which you all know, but I'll briefly touch upon some of these tests during my presentation. Thomas test, I think, will be taken up in detail by Professor Manoj Kumar. Hip deformities can be fixed flexion deformity, pigeon toe gait, scissoring and subluxation, dislocation of the hip, I have all very briefly described. Now this is another gait called a W type of posture. A patient who has an excessive moral antiduction, they sit like a W like this because of this. This is also called Sartor's gait or Taylor's gait or a W gait. So this is because of excessive moral antiduction, which is often seen in cases of cerebral palsy. Duncan Ellis test, rectus femoris is tight. You make the patient prone, and when you flex the knee joint, the buttocks rise because of the rectus femoris tightness. This is a video for that. You flex the knee and the buttocks rise. When I'm doing it rapidly, the buttocks rise faster because this is a velocity dependent phenomenon. So combination of tight hamstring and rectus. This can be a situation where the rectus femoris is also tight and the hamstrings are also tight. There the patient will walk with a stiff knee gait. And in this case, if you do a hamstring lengthening, the knee will go into hyperextension. So in those situations, you have to reduce the strength of the gastrocnemius by distal transfer to sartorius. Now, this is an example. You take a strip of the sartorius and you may put it on the semitendinosus if the knee limb is in internal rotation. And you may put it into biceps as the limb is into external rotation. So Phelps confusion test. In this test, it indicates a restless tightness. When you do this test, it's like a Barbara's or Otterlund test. You're not able to abduct the hips. But when the knee is flexed, you are able to achieve more abduction. As you extend the knee, the thighs tend to come closer because of the peculiar anatomy of the restless, which we have already described. So adductor contracture will have this type of scissoring gait, and adductor release will correct all these deformities. Hip dislocation. If this location is difficult to treat, it is best prevented in cases of cerebral palsy, although who have a angiosuous spasticity and a weakness of hip extensor than a doctor, the hip will tend to dislocate. And you may have to reduce the strength of the adductors and increase. This is one of the indices called Reimer's index, where you are finding out the amount of hip dislocation. So you have to do muscle imbalance in these cases by releasing, correct the muscle imbalance by releasing the adductors. And the coxa valga is usually a natural sequelae of this condition. Because you see, whenever the gluteus medius is weak, the stimulus to the apophysis of the greater trochanter is reduced. So the neck goes into coxa valga. So you may have to reduce this by doing a varus depression osteotomy, what we do in Barthes disease. So the take home message in cerebral palsy is, spasticity control is the key. Before the age of 8 years, by non-operative treatment as far as possible, casting, orthosis or Botox, up to the age of 4 to 8, this lengthening versus flexional lengthening. So lengthening is almost always not required. If flexional lengthening is more often required, bony surgery usually after the age of 2, when not to approach. So there are patients who have a cortical neglect. And simply because you know the surgery, you should not do the surgery. So because even after doing any surgery, you cannot improve if there's a cortical neglect on the brain. And surgery may have to be repeated. In case you have to do a surgery before the second growth spurt, you may have to repeat the surgical intervention. You have to guard the patient that a second surgical intervention may be required. Thank you so much. I hope you understand a very simple presentation. If you want to ask